checking into a psychiatric hospital, well, it wasn't really part of the plan. And this book, well, that wasn't either. You see, I spent years in hiding, trying to maintain this facade, because after all, manny up, well, manny up was a socially ingrained way of thinking. It wasn't necessarily the lifestyle that drew me in. I knew absolutely nothing about military life. I joined up, as many of us did at the time, because of this promise of brotherhood. This family, united by a powerful set of ideals. Things like honour, duty, service, courage, integrity. It felt like an adventure, like I belonged to something really worthwhile. And you know, military training, well, it taught me to push both my physical and my mental limits continually. I became a tougher, rougher version of me, a little less human, but I was pleased with the results. I loved the discipline. I loved the sense of urgency, learning to exist constantly primed. And belonging, well, belonging was this powerful uniting force, but it was strictly conditional. There becomes this contagious drive to jettison the weak, to banish the sick, the lame, the lazy. And so I learned very quickly to hide any sense of vulnerability. I didn't want to be the girl on the parade square that looked weak. I certainly didn't want to be the girl with a high-pitched squeal. I was constantly fighting not to be othered, and so I swore and I yelled as I forced my curvier peg into the army's square-cut hole. Shaming those who dared to deviate from the norm, this hyper-masculine ideal, well, it served to galvanize our sense of unity. I was part of that. It felt like a rite of passage. I didn't recognize it as gendered at the time. Maybe it was because I was so immersed. Training is indoctrinating and lasts long after you've left the army. Maybe it was because, well, it was simply a sense of loyalty. I loved what the army stood for. I relished this carefully constructed identity, and I believed that if I were tough, well, then I'd be safe. If I were tough, they would treat me that way. And you know what? The army began teaching me that I was capable of achieving so much more than I ever imagined. And I miss being a sister in the Brotherhood. I miss the connection. I miss knowing that someone's got me back. The soldiers, the military language, the adrenaline, the discipline, the focus, I miss all of that. But I do not miss wearing men's combat boots in a smaller size because they didn't make kit for women. And I don't miss wearing uniform that cut across my boobs and my thighs. I do not miss the less palatable side. During my early months as a young troop commander, I was sexually assaulted. It was Christmas drinks with officers going to the sergeant's mess. The atmosphere was boozy and boorish. There was this assault course with a gym box and a trampette, and you had to get across it, down a pint of beer before they even let you in through the doors. It was expected, demanded even, that everyone would join in. And as I was leaving, a senior soldier with over 20 years' experience approached me and forced me into a small closet. I remember the stench of his breath, his hands lunging all over my body. I didn't complain. Uninvited groping, well, it was just part of the deal. It was just the way it was. I didn't know who to turn to or what to say. And speaking out would have been career limiting. We were bound by the rules and we were trapped behind the wire. And then my first real leadership test came when I was deployed to the Balkans in 1998. I was 25 years old and I was leading a multinational patrol to the west of Kosovo. It was our role to verify, which essentially meant we were there to gather information, to document what was actually happening on the ground. And this would pave the way for the Future Later campaign that happened later in 1999. Now, we were living amongst the community. We were dressed in civilian clothing. There was no rank, and we were unarmed. It was 24/7, 7 days a week. Kosovo, well, it was the best of times professionally, and yet Kosovo was the worst of times personally. There were moments when I felt utterly helpless, forced to bear witness to the atrocities of ethnic cleansing, and yet powerless to intervene. Recognised as the best young officer within the Corps. Playing sport at the highest level, I captained my country in a World Cup, and on the outside, things were looking good. But I was running on fumes, and I was engaging in every self-destructive behaviour you might wish to name. I learned to survive by racing forwards, running faster, faster, never stopping for too long because, well, the quiet frightened me. And through my ongoing achievements, my ongoing public accolades, to the outside world, I seemed just fine. But behind closed doors, I was living on vodka, Valium, sleeping pills, antidepressants, anything really to numb the pain. Flashbacks would haunt me. Being there again and again, the smells, the faces. And soon, well, my body became ill, as well as my mind. And no one said anything. Whilst in uniform, there was just no place to put it into words, to unravel it, to try and make sense of its meaning. I tried, but then the Brotherhood, they seemed to scatter like I had some kind of contagious disease. Before long, the gossip started. My medical notes were shared through the chain of command. When the military community starts to deny your distress to protect their own narrative, it's profoundly damaging. And I found myself consumed by this volcanic rage. It fell apart. I fell apart. I'd invested so much in this strong, resilient soldier image, and yet it just wasn't holding together anymore. And so for years, I continued to hide. Eventually, I left the army of my own accord, angry, running away, perhaps hoping that the nightmares would stop. But my failure to live up to the soldier ideal carried with them a deep and a consuming source of shame. I couldn't look at it, I couldn't feel it, and I certainly couldn't tolerate its meaning. And then my failure to conform to what was expected of me outside of the wire as a woman and then as a mum, well, it began to crush what fragile reserves I had left. Everything the military had taught me was now in civilian circles deemed too aggressive, too masculine, too forthright. Add to that, trying to hide a mental illness, and it confirmed that, frankly, something was fundamentally wrong with me. It was like living life in a pressure cooker, silently screaming. Now, eventually, I was admitted to a psychiatric hospital. And for the first time, I was diagnosed with severe post-traumatic stress disorder as a direct result of my military service. Now, frankly, heavily medicated, life took on a rather welcome haze. But I do remember the bell. I remember it ringing and then lining up for medication. This hatch would open on the other side of the corridor, and a nurse would present this paper white cup. I'd take the tablets, she'd make you open your mouth, and she'd check under your tongue. I remember police search helicopters, police dogs, 15-minute observations, and this peephole in my door that only looked in rather than out. You know who you are when you're in a psychiatric hospital because friends don't tend to come and visit and bring you a magazine and grapes. whisper is humiliating. But a silence is suffocating. I started writing in that same hospital as a form of therapy. I was trying to make some kind of sense of it all. And for years, those pages, well, they sat locked in a secret drawer because I still felt a deep loyalty to the British Army. And honestly, I was also terrified to share it because of what you might think of me. And then I read the recent cases of Officer Cadet Olivia Perks, Gunner Jason Bex, and the thousands of women giving evidence in the Atherton inquiry. The stories of the Red Arrows, crushed depth rape lists on our submarines. Their stories could be my story. Little has changed. And I now feel a duty to speak out, to share my story as part of a fierce and an urgent call for culture change. Today, I can still see their faces. Not in detail anymore, but their eyes are still present, often wide open and searching in the middle of the night. But as much as some of the past still haunts me, almost everything that I went through, going right to the edge and looking over it, it has helped me grow as a mum, as a human being, as a friend, as a leader, and as a wife. I have learned to value the womanhood that is so essential to my being. And through it all, it's forced me to abandon the pretense. It's forced me to re-examine my beliefs and to reset my priorities. Today, I belong to a very different tribe. And I'm finding the courage to reclaim the lost pieces. I suppose you could say that it's not despite, but because of my past, that today I'm finding new meaning. My three children now laugh with me. We chuckle when I fall out of my seat in a cinema or when I dive for cover in broad daylight. They announce their arrival before entering a room and they protect me from the deadly threat of fireworks or party balloons that make me so uptight. They offer me the corner seat in the coffee shop so that I can see who enters and who leaves. It's their love that haunts me. And in that sense, some of the darkest times that we've shared together as a family have today become the most sacred. Now, I'd love to finish today on this glittery lunch with a Hollywood ending. The truth is, it's messy. The experience is still very much alive. It's breathing and moving inside of me. And even standing here in front of you today, it's fear that grips me. But staying silent nearly killed me. By sharing my story, it allows me to own what has happened, and it allows me to control the ending. Pink camouflage is indeed raw and it's unfiltered. After all, it was written in therapy and it may even be unpalatable for some people. But I will no longer minimize myself just to fit in. My hope is that by sharing my truth, it might maybe help someone else who might be suffering. This is me. Thank you for listening.